Hey, what up, guys? I'm Kiwivurse coming at you with another video. Today, I am joined by none other than
KamBoz.
Yeah, today we're gonna be talking about the Killing Joke. So, spoiler alerts if you have not seen and or read it. And yeah, this is our spoiler cast. So, starting off, what was your opinion of the movie? Because I already have a review up. I told my opinions in that video, link in the description. I want to hear KamBoz's view.
Well, I don't know. I thought that it was really good. It was really well based off of the comic, The Killing Joke, or the graphic novel. You know, it was really a lot of like iconic scenes where I noticed where it was like, oh my gosh, I remember seeing that. So, yeah. And I thought it was really well like paced or whatever. And I don't know, I just thought it was really good.
Okay, yeah, I pretty much agree with all that. Obviously, just right off the panel. What were some of your major like cons or dislikes about the movie?
Cons? I think you already know this one. It was the scene where Batman and Batgirl they get pretty frisky, if you know.
They get pretty bat cessed.
Oh yeah, bat cessed.
Oh my goodness. But okay, well, on that note, let's start off, let's dive right in, let's talk about the prologue. All right, now obviously prologue, I could see what they were trying to do. They were trying to just establish Barbara as a character, as Batgirl. Obviously they were trying to make her relationship very, very strong with Batman, and they thought, like, because they got to do it kind of like short because they only got like 30-40 minutes to do it. So they probably thought that the easiest or best way to do that would be to have them be lovers. Now, what is your opinion on that?
I think that wasn't really the right way to go, to be honest. Like, I understand that Batgirl and Batman, they're like supposed to have a strong relationship because apparently it's supposed to be like a long time thing. Like, if you look back at Bad Blood, her suit was different than Killing Joke. So, obviously, there was some time in between that where she was Batgirl and looking for Batman and stuff. So,
yeah, but, like, I don't know if this animated movie is in canon with the other DC animated films. Are they?
I'd expect it to be, kind of. But then again, if it was, I feel like, because the other DC animated films, there's a continuity, I guess, with... The League of Shadows, Nightwing, and like Damian Wayne, I felt like they were just kind of like not really present, and it felt kind of weird. I was like, when's Nightwing gonna show up or something, because that was just like the continuity. So I don't really know if they're canon with this or not.
I don't know. I thought this might have just been a standalone project strictly based off of the comic, but I don't know. Either way, yeah, they have a strong relationship, but it's more like a father-daughter relationship rather than a lover relationship.
True.
You know what I'm saying? But, yeah, there are a lot of scenes in this. Okay, so let's talk about the main villain in the prologue, which is this guy. I forgot what his name was. That mob boss's son.
Oh, it was his nephew. It was Franz Paris, oh, yeah. I remember.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Freaking Paris. Why is it that, like, every fictional character named Paris just... dislikable. I don't know. Basically, he had this whole complex with Batgirl. He was like messing with her. He was what's the word? Freaking
obsessing.
Yeah, yeah. And he was almost like, it was weird because it was somewhat sexual too, which I thought was weird because you remember there was that scene on the boat where they had all the strippers or like hookers. And then the one was wearing a Batman mask to, like, make it look like he was, like, having intercourse with Batgirl. That was weird.
Yeah. That's kind of off.
Yeah, but, and then there was a whole thing where that was the reason why Batman didn't want her facing against him, because he was kind of obsessed with her, almost as Joker is obsessed with Batman, and Batman's trying to say, like, when they get that infatuated with you, it's very dangerous, and he just didn't want her getting involved. And then the whole rooftop scene unrolls, and bang, her shirt's off.
Yep, basically.
Honestly, I saw what they were trying to do, And it could have been worse at some points. I mean, they definitely could have done it better. There was definitely room for improvement. But it, I mean, it wasn't too bad. Because there were parts of the prologue that I did enjoy. Parts that I didn't enjoy. Freaking the library. The library parts.
Oh, yeah.
Where it's like girl talk with that one gay librarian. And it's just, it's weird.
Yeah.
Oh, dude, you remember that one scene? The one scene where she's walking out of the cafe and her and Batman are going through some turmoil. And then she sees another couple having some problems. And it's like, it's so weird. It's like,
right,
she walks
it's
past
so
them.
Off.
Yeah, what did you think about that?
It was just like, honestly, I would've, if I was Barbara in that situation, I would've just walked by because every relationship has their problems. And like,
right.
It's just weird you taking your anger out on some random people just literally just arguing, which people do literally every day. Like, I can say that I argue with my sister every single day. So, like, flipping some guy over your shoulder over some bushes just because, like, he wants some space from a girl.
Yeah.
Like for nothing, really. It's just not...
It's not representing the character of Barbara
good
at all.
Like, she's supposed to be freaking smart.
She looks like a douchebag. Like, literally, it's not like he was, like, beating on her or anything. He was literally saying, I need some space. Then she freaking choke slams him into a bush and says, like, there's your space. You
freaking, oh, my
gosh. You freaking, oh, my God. I don't know. It was almost like they were trying to give Barbara a strong, like, woman role, which I have nothing wrong with. Strong women leads. Obviously, we're getting Wonder Woman in the movie. But, like, that's almost too far for me. That's just, like, you can be a strong, like, standing, like, woman, but you don't, that's just,
you don't need to flip guys over bushes just because you're a strong female lead.
Yeah. It's, like, I don't know. It almost goes to an extreme.
Yeah.
But, yeah, prologue, not too happy with it. I mean, I wish it would have been a cooler villain rather than just some guy who was sexually obsessed over Batgirl.
Yeah, I feel like maybe they could have brought in, instead of, like, some random mob family, they could have, like, brought in, like, Don Falcone or, like, one of those, like, major Batman crime bosses.
Yeah. Or, I mean, even, like, a someone smaller. Like, I mean, you could even go as, like, big as Two-Face. It could just be, like, an easy Two-Face, like, he's robbing banks, something happens.
Yeah.
And then you can avoid the Batman sex thing.
True.
But then you can also establish a good bond between Batgirl and Batman because they team up to take down Two-Face. And this one, it just, I feel like when they eloped or engaged in coitus, as you like to say, it almost drove them further apart because then it's like awkward, and she's like, it was just sex, Batman. It's just like, was it?
That's even more awkward than just having it.
It's like, and then like, then Batman's distracted in the Batmobile. It's like, god dang it. And then like, freaking, he's not paying attention. Like, the freaking Batmobile gets shot a freaking bazooka at it. It's like, oh god, dude.
Right.
First you do it, and then it continues to affect you negatively. It's just, oh man.
It's like,
it's just so wrong on so many levels.
Like, Batman, you know him for, like, having no emotion. So, mm-hmm. to see him, like Barbara engaged in it. Like, Batgirl engaged in it. And then,
well, you know, I don't really like the Batman with no emotion. I want Batman to have a little bit of emotion.
I mean, everyone wants Batman to have a little bit of emotion at least. But, like, to see him reacting that way and, like, just, like, give into it. That's just, like, no. Like, they're, like, 20 years apart. And, like, every Batman companion, like, sidekick, is, like, always, like, a father and like, child kind of relationship. It's never supposed to be, like, sexual.
Yeah.
Like, it's never been sexual. Like, save that for Catwoman, man.
Yeah. And basically, like, doing freaking, the one major gripe I have with the Arkham games is that Batman is this guy with practically no emotion, and, like, whenever Robin or Batgirl or Nightwing are like, yo, dude, do you need some help? And he's like, no, I don't need any help. I'm Batman. And then he just gets that whole thing, and it's just like, okay, this Batman's gonna do his thing. I mean, and he gets it done. But I mean, I love to see those freaking moments when, like, Robin cracking jokes while they're, like, on mission, and then Batman's just like, okay. And then with Batgirl, it's almost like they're. Batgirl and them, I mean, they're almost equals by now, I guess. And I mean, I don't think they would ever be equals enough to be lovers. I think Barbara and Dick Grayson are equals enough to be lovers, and we've seen that in the comics. They have a relationship.
Yeah, very true. Yeah.
And I like that relationship better. And literally, Bruce just freaking, he just destroyed the bro code with freaking Dick. Like,
right, like your bat dad. Like, this isn't a porno.
Boy, it was just, oh my god, like, you hear about Batman, he takes these kids under his wing, literally, but in this movie, he took her under his pants. that's just me putting it there, just saying the elephant in the room, and that's just my opinion on it. But, yeah, aside from the prologue, let's talk about some other stuff for the rest of the movie. Obviously, they did the Killing Joke, spot on, perfect. There was a couple things that I noticed. How did you feel about Batman killing people in this movie? Because he did kill a couple people.
Yeah, he definitely killed a couple people. And that really, like, during those scenes, all I could think about,
like,
was...
Wait, like, which ones are you thinking about particularly?
I don't really know.
Because I have one in mind. Because, like, there's a point where he's in the, like, the freaking roller coaster of doom or whatever. He's trying to get Commissioner Gordon out of there, and he's like fighting the little, like, midget weird things, and he literally, like, a pit of spikes opens beneath them, and Batman literally throws one of those midgets down into the spikes.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what? And it's just like, and it's, people are just like, oh dude, he probably lived. I mean, he probably just, like,
there's no way you could live through that.
He probably just, like, broke his leg or something. But it's like, no, dude, he freaking died. He threw him into the spikes, and I think they even added a sound effect like a swing. Like, oh my goodness. So yeah, I mean, it's not major. I mean, it's not as obvious as it was in, say, Batman v Superman. But still, I have a problem with Batman killing people, and I don't know. It's weird.
Yeah, like, Batman killing people, it's never really been his style. Like, Batman, like, he's always said, I don't kill, because, like, it's like the one quote, if you kill a killer, you become, like, the number of killers in the world stays the same. So, like, that's always been, yeah, like, Batman's motive to not kill. And then, like, in Batman v Superman, and then in this Batman Killing Joke movie, like, you see him killing, and it's kind of, like, making fans question, like, is Batman, like, it's gonna start killing even in the comics now, like, because, like, Batman killing is just not normal. It's not his thing. So, like, I don't know. That scene kind of, like, made me kind of, like, question, like, is this Batman the same Batman as I'm used to?
Yeah, I mean, it turned me off a bit of the movie. It was just, like, kind of, like, one of those moments where I was like, oh, dang, he just freaking killed that guy. And, I mean, obviously, Batman is not going to be 100%. I mean, he's killed people before, and he's had to.
Yeah. But those are, like, extreme circumstances.
Yeah, every hero has to kill people. Like, Man of Steel, I wouldn't say he had to kill Zod, but, like...
True.
He did. He did it. And, I mean, I accept that he killed Zod. And, but, like, in this, you literally threw the guy right in there, but... And then, I don't know. I mean, if you can avoid it, you can avoid it. But if you can't, you obviously can't. But if you can't, make it, like, a big deal. Make it a big deal. Don't make it one of those things that, it happens in 2 seconds, and you just hope the audience won't, like, notice it. Like, make it a big thing. Like, if you're going to make it that quick, then you might as well just make him throw him off to the side. Why make him throw? Like, it's just, like, it's weird, because when they're editing this, they could have just as easily animated him throwing him off to the side, off screen, where you don't see what happens to him. And obviously this is off screen, but you see him literally throw him down into the pit, and it's just like one of those things that could be fixed like that. And it's just
true.
It's
true.
Not, it's weird. But what else do I want to talk about? Oh, Easter eggs. There was actually one Easter egg in this film, which I noticed. Not sure if anyone else did. Before I say mine, did you notice any Easter eggs in this film?
Yeah, I noticed an Easter egg, and I think I know what you're talking about.
Okay. Which one was it?
It was the one where, like, there's all the screens. Not when Gordon is on the roller coaster, but where Joker is, like, in front of, like, all the screens. And you see, like, the different pictures of the Joker. And then, like, he was in, like, different positions and stuff. And there was one where he was, like, on the beach with some seagulls, and one where he was, like, in a jail cell in that, like, vest, like, suit vest. Like, that was the one Easter egg that I really liked.
Yeah, that was the one I saw, and I had actually paused it. Basically, essentially, if you didn't notice it, Batman's on the back computer. He sees that Joker is loose again, so he's pulling up a bunch of pictures of Joker just, like, kind of looking at him and, like, saying, like, trying to, I guess, find a pattern between his, crimes, which obviously there is none, but he's still looking at these photos, and he's talking to Alfred, and there's one photo. There's just a bunch of random ones. One actually looked like, I believe it was reminiscent of Joker the Man Who Laughed, that cover. Just look up Joker the Man Who Laughs. And I think there was one that was looking like that cover, but then obviously the other one that Cambo stated was him in that sweater vest, which was totally a nod to Heath Ledger's In the Dark Knight.
Yeah.
So, I thought that was cool. I thought that was a cool little thing that they put in there. There's probably more stuff that we just, like, didn't notice or didn't remember. But,
Yeah, I think I'm going to watch this again to, like, see if I can, like, pick up any more spoilers. Because there's definitely, like, in films today, there's definitely, like, bound to be tons of spoilers that you just missed. You're not looking that much. Like, maybe in the library, in one of the library scenes, you know, there's a spoiler there.
Oh, God. Just cut those out of the movie. Just cut them out of the movie.
Yeah.
It's almost cringy to me thinking about it, but I'm not going to be one of those guys who's just like, Batman and Batgirl have sex and he's like, no. I mean, honestly, if they did it better, maybe I would have been more obliged to it. Like, if they set it up better and it was just like executed maybe a little bit better, then I would have been okay with it. But this is something that we have never really seen before. And if you're going to do something we've never seen before, you got to do it right or else you're going to get a bad response.
True, yeah.
So, do you have anything else to, any points you want to bring up?
I kind of wanted to bring up the whole, like, Joker's backstory.
Like, okay, yeah.
I really like that. Mm-hmm, but, mm-hmm. And, like, I mean, I know that there isn't really, like, we don't live in, like, the DC universe, so there's no way of us for, like, checking, like, records and stuff to see, like, where he was when he did that one showing, so that, like, we could figure out who the Joker is. But I think that, like, showing that could, like, maybe move people to try and figure out who the Joker is based on, like, I don't know, maybe some super fan is gonna, like, look in all the issues of comics and see a list of comedians and all the times through in Gotham City and be like, oh, that guy was there in that place, and that must be the Joker. Maybe we're going to find out who the Joker is, but that's very unlikely. But I don't know. I just like seeing the Joker's backstory because I really don't think I'd seen it before. All I knew was that Joker was in the Red Hood gang before he became the Joker, and then he fell into that vat of, like, acid or whatever, and he transformed. And I really liked how they, like, went back and forth with the whole backstory thing.
Yeah, but here's the thing. We don't know if that is the definitive origin of the Joker. Now, it is definitely the most common one that you see when you look up origin of the Joker. It's the one, obviously, it was made famous in this book and this movie, and it was the one that was actually in the Batman Arkham Origins. You go through a thing where he's, like, talking about his backstory and stuff like that. And obviously there's been, like, other things. And this is probably the most, I guess, talked about origin of the Joker. But he actually says in this movie, he's talking about it. And I believe, I don't know the full exact line, but you can listen to it or read it. And it basically says, I prefer my past to be multiple choice. So he could just be making this up. And I mean, he makes up, like, so many different, past lives about himself. And it's one of the cool things about the Joker that we will never know who he is. And I actually hope that we never find out.
Yeah,
I think because that's it's just the good part. Yeah, it just makes the character more interesting and just defines him a little bit differently from the rest.
Yeah, like, which I think is the Joker, cool. like no puns intended, but the Joker is really more enigmatic than the Riddler, to be honest.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's not his gimmick, but overall, true. Yeah.
And then, like, when you, like, how he said, like, I prefer my past to be multiple choice, and how you said that he could be making, like, all this up, that kind of made me think about Young Justice. I know this really doesn't have anything to do with the movie, but I remember in one episode of Young Justice, Poison Ivy said that Joker was doing good controlling all these different plant monsters, and he was like, thanks, I have experience juggling my multiple personalities.
Oh.
So it's kind of like, the Joker is like, maybe that backstory is just one of the many of his multiple personalities.
Yeah, I mean, maybe he just forgot his actual story by now, just by going insane. He just escaped his reality, like he says in this movie. And he's gone completely mad, and now he just, all he can do is make up stories about what he thinks might have happened.
Yeah, true.
I think that's actually cool. It's actually very cool lore. And I wish there were actually more, because this is, like, when you think Joker's backstory, you think of this story. You think of the Killing Joke. But this is just one story. Like, I wish there were, like, more, sequences of events that led up to him becoming the Joker instead of this one theory. I mean, obviously there's probably a bunch of others, but I wish they were more, I guess, popular.
Yeah, like, you know? I think one Joker backstory is that he was the one that killed Batman's parents, and this was before, like, the comic came out where he caught his parents, or his parents' killer. So
yeah.
There was one story where Joker was the killer of Batman's parents, and that's why they were, like, so, like, destined to be connected and, like, fighting for, like, all this time. But then he caught his parents' killer, so that kind of died.
Yeah, yeah.
But I really wish that he hadn't caught them. That way that kind of would have, like, lived on a little bit longer.
Yeah, then there's that also the thing that just happened recently in the New 52. I'm not caught up in comics at all.
Me neither.
And I'm sorry.
Me neither.
But I believe this happened in the Justice League comic, like, I believe it was, like, Dark Side War or something to do with that. And, like, Batman sat in this chair. It was, like, the chair of, like, knowledge, like a god chair. And he could just have any of the information in the world. So he asks it, what is the Joker's real name?
Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
And then it tells him, and he's like, oh, my God. But then we don't figure out. I don't know if it's later revealed, but, like, I don't know. I mean, that's pretty cool. That was a pretty cool thing, because it's like, it turns out it's Alfred the whole time. That would be insane.
Oh, yeah.
That's funny. Don't know.
Like, I remember there's also, I saw a little comic strip where it shows Alfred dressing up as the Joker. But, like, that's all it shows. And, like, someone captioned the picture. It was like, Alfred is so loyal that he dresses up as a villain so that Batman has something to do. And it's like, that's also a pretty good story. Like, maybe the Joker is just Alfred letting out some steam and also helping Batman kind of get through his turmoil that happened when he was 8 years old.
That would actually be really different, and that would actually be really cool and interesting.
Yeah.
Kind of creepy, though, too.
True.
But, yeah, so, I mean, I think we're about ready to wrap this video up. Any last words?
Yeah, if you haven't seen this movie, go see it, because it's really awesome.
Yeah,
especially if you're not really, you know, all that interested in Batman. I feel like this will really interest you in Batman a lot.
I mean, definitely read the comic.
Yeah, true.
Before you see the movie,
because that way you enjoy it the most. You're like, oh, hey, there goes that one scene.
Yeah, because I wish I read the book before I saw the movie, because, like, it's been so long since I've actually read the book. And I just watched the movie without having really any context except for, like, my old memory. But, like, there's probably a lot of scenes there and just, like, text ripped off right off the pages. And
yeah, I feel like there is, though. It just feels, honestly, like one of those things that, like, they just rip stuff right off the page.
Yeah, they did it almost verbatim. And on obviously Mark Hamill, Kevin Conroy, just perfect. Just
yeah,
as always, you know, it's nothing to be surprised about. Just they're expected to be the best, and they are. So it's very entertaining. And yeah, I think that's about to wrap this up. It's around freaking. We've been talking about this for 25 minutes. Be sure to comment your guys' opinions on whether it be the Joker's origin, whether it be the prologue, whether it be about anything. Go check out KamBoz's channel if you are on my channel. Be sure to slap a like on this video if you enjoyed it. And remember, for all your videos on the comic universe, we got you covered right here on Kiwivurse. Peace out, guys.
Peace.